Hi everyone, this is Pierrick from P2design. Environment and composition are key components to enhance your animations. They provide visual landmarks and guide your audience attention. In this free sample from the upcoming chapter of my Blender animation course Alive, I will show you how I created the environment for this animation and what you can do to get great composition in yours. Let's get started. While this is not the core subject of this course, you may not neglect the environment whenever you are working on an animation. If you're working on a simple gameplay animation, like the one I do for Nohara, it's totally fine to not have any environment at all. But when you're working on such an animation for your portfolio, if you put a little bit of effort in every field, like FX's and environment, it will show the recruiter other skill and also the fact that you care to output a nice product. This can be some extra point for your profile. But if you are absolutely not competent in modeling or shading, keep it simple and just focus on your animation. In the beginning of this chapter, I've shown you that I've built a very simple environment with a visual reference of the character position in space. And now is the time to create a real environment. It's generally easier to work on indoor environment, like the simple scene I did for my iAnimate assignment, but for this one I knew I wanted an outdoor environment. I wanted to keep it as simple as possible, with pointy and sharp shapes, thing easy to model and easy to compose. So I started with a low poly circle that I would extrude, and as for anything art related, you should always start with the broader shapes. I will directly place this extruded object in the background, give it a couple of extrusion, and give it a fang shape. And I will slightly push it to the left so that it leads to the character. The silhouette of the rock will guide the viewer. Let's have a look to some Riot Games League of Legends Wild Rift character presentation. Have a look to the environment and focus on the broad shapes. Some are super obvious like the one in red, but there are also secondary shapes like the path, all leading to the character. Color value, or light if you prefer, also focus on the character. And this is something you will find in all their artwork whenever they are focusing on a character. While it's super easy to get lost in their environment because they are gorgeous and filled with details, the composition lines are so obvious that you should be focusing on this as an animator. And with this in mind, discuss with the environment department, and if you're in charge of the environment, focus on this first. I gave some rhythm to the silhouette of my rock by first beveling the horizontal loops pressing Ctrl+B, and then shrinking the geometry using Alt+S to scale it along the normals. I repeated the process a couple of times, and then I just merged the top part of the rock. Once you have this simple shape, you can add some detail by just pushing and pulling some of the vertices to give it some variation, some randomness. You can also add a couple of loop cuts, but keep it as simple as possible and as low poly as possible. I'm just rotating it a bit, moving some of the vertices. I'm not adding any new geometry, just pulling and pushing some of the verts until I get a nice silhouette. I created a couple of additional rocks, following the same principle, using a simple circle that I would extrude, and I would give them different scale. It's better to create a new model than taking the big one and scale it down. Take the picture of a rock and you copy and paste it, and then you scale it down trying to make it look like a stone. You won't be able to trick your audience because the level of detail in that rock, its geometry, the shapes of the shadow won't match what it will be if it was a simple stone. It will be way too noisy and will look like a scaled down stone. With this in mind, I will create a free scale level for the different stones. The three level of detail rule is very important in art. When we were talking about rhythm in our animation, we also pointed out that uneven numbers or uneven rhythm are generally more appealing for your animation. If you want a better grasp on this concept, check out the presentation by Gleb Alexandrov on the secret of making high quality art. I put the link in the documentation. Once I have those additional rocks, I will simply position them and try to get a nice composition as seen in the beginning of this video, where the environment is used to guide the viewer toward the character. From there, I will jump between the different key poses of the character, and I will either create new rocks or duplicate them, Here, for example, I'm focusing on the moment he catches the trident, and I'm trying to position rock tips so that it supports the character. Then I will scrub till the character lands, and I will see if I can better shape the mountain so that it also supports the next pose, or at least it doesn't destroy the composition. For each of these moments where we don't have that much camera motion, I will make sure that the composition supports the character, that the main shapes reads well, that I have my main shapes, secondary shapes or medium details, and also some small details or high frequency details. Silhouette of my character is clear, I don't have any tangent with the environment. So basically, deal with the environment as if it was a secondary character. And the silhouette and shapes of your character may not be in conflict with the environment. Applying the same rule we saw in Chapter 7. Once I've populated my scene, what I did was to change a bit the shading of those tones. To do so, I selected them all and then pressed Ctrl-J to join the object into a single object. You can right-click and select Shade Smooth. From there, I can keep some sharp edges, going into the Vertex Data option, under Normals, enabling Auto Smooth. Now, part of the rocks have sharp angles, while others are very smooth, creating a nice rhythm. You should experiment a bit with the angle threshold value to get different results. From there, scrubbing through the animation, I've edited some of the rock depending on what I was seeing on the camera view. You can mix a bit of sculpting using the grab brush just to push and pull the different part of the rock a little faster. I just want to prevent the same rock pattern from repeating on screen. In edit mode, you can press K to access the knife tool and cut some new edges or faces to create slice and plateau on the side of your rocks, just to create another rhythm. Again, the idea is to prevent them from looking the same. Adding detail is great, but keep them as simple as possible. Most of the composition came from the rocks or the mountain, call them as you wish, but the previous tide, the floor, wasn't relevant anymore. Remember that I built it to have a landmark regarding the position of my character in space. I replaced it by a simple plane that I will subdivide just to have a little more details, even though it's perfectly flat. From there, in edit mode, I use the knife tool to draw some sharp shapes. And I will then pull those vertices up and it will create nice fractures on the ground. As I did when I was positioning the different rocks and stones, I will just scrub through the animation and give some simple details to the ground, making sure that it doesn't contest my character animation. Remember, the environment is not the main subject here. It's just here to support the animation of the character. If we now have a look to the color palette of this animation, you can see I used pretty desaturated blue colors in contrast with the red color of the character. This course is not about creating materials, but you can access them in the files. And they are very simple. The crown and the rocks use almost the same material. It's just a couple of noise mixed to drive a color ramp, and that's it. On top of this, I've mixed a third noise that drives a simple bump. The sky was a little more complex, but I've already published a full tutorial on how to create it. You will find the link in the documentation. There are several lights in the scene, but the lighting is pretty simple. I have a key sunlight that I've positioned so that the character is lit in from the side. It better shows the volume of the character and also it casts a nice shadow on the ground, allowing us to better read the character position in space. You may avoid aligning your key light with the camera, as your character won't cast that much shadow and it won't read well. Having the key light facing the camera will lead to the same result. It won't read well. So it's nice to have a side lightning or a three-quarter lightning based on the camera position. This rule can be broken to create different moods, but if you're not a lighting artist, that's a good base rule. And then most of the additional light I've placed in the scene are rim lights. Most of the time I've used spotlights so that I can isolate the character. I rotated them so that they don't lit the ground or the rocks. And it shows whenever we see it from the side. If I now rotate the cone down, you can see it now lit the ground. We can clearly see the benefit of this rim light when the character is airborne. I placed a couple of spotlight slightly in the back of the character. The strength of the light is pretty big, and it's positioned almost on the opposite side based on the camera position, so that it does lit the edges of the character. This is a classic to make the silhouette of your character pop. You should find the benefit pretty obvious if I switch it off. So you can use the environment to emphasize the animation of your character, keep the environment simple and not too contrasted, and you can also use lights to bring more readability to your animation. And keep it simple, especially if you are not a specialist in lighting or environment. This can improve your animation, but it won't land you a job as an animator.